Good afternoon. A warm afternoon might become very hot actually in a very short while. I'm so happy to have Josy back into Hyderabad for the second time. And this happens thanks largely to the huge fan following and popularity that he has amongst the thinking population in Hyderabad. Welcome, Josy. Friends, if there's one book, just one book that you can read, there's only one book that I would recommend that you read, and that is A Feast of Vultures that he has written. It's a book of seminal importance, of unimaginable bravery, courage, and of the kind of work one expects from a journalist. I would rank Josy as one of the top three Indian journalists today, and I would salute him for the kind of work that he has done. Friends, the title of today's session is India on Sale, and I hope you understand what it means. This country is for sale, and that is what this book is about. We'll go through some of the things, but before we even start, let me ask Josy. By the way, I want you all to know that Josy is the one who has been instrumental in several frauds that were discovered and reported over the last 20 years, 20 plus years. He has been a journalist for over 20 years now. Whether you talk of the 2G scam, where he had a significant contribution, the Commonwealth Games scam, the LTC concession scam, the Adarsh housing scam. In many scams that you see, big and small, Josy had a serious role to play. And what he says is that he has discovered much more which even regular mainstream media was not willing to publish. And that goes into this book.
Yeah, good afternoon. I wrote this book because my mainstream job was not really permitting me to report everything that I knew about contemporary India. For years that I've been carrying a folder in my email called Morgue. It's a mortuary of the dead stories that newspapers would not publish. So I said about sometime in 2007, I said I wanted to write this book which without any censorship or varnish. And that is how this book came about. And I hope I've done justice to my commitment not to do censorship. The book actually begins in a Bihar village where villagers are struggling to get a road, electricity, hospital. And it ends outside the house of the most expensive house that an Indian has ever built, Mukesh Ambani's Antedia. To me, that journey from that Bihar village to Mukesh Ambani's house is telling in many ways about India that we inherit and we live in. And their book is based on one academic perception, which is that everything in this country is on sale. You need to know the right middleman and pay the right price. And my effort in the book is to prove my theory through stories of various people, big, small, and...
I found an interesting excerpt in the context of what you said. I'm reading from that book. The rules of the game in modern India are very simple. Even if the structure it creates is a horribly tangled maze, in this country, it is okay to do practically anything. Use fake promoters, accept bribes, commission murders, intimidate media, manipulate courts, and grab power. The one big rule, don't get caught. Would you like to say something?
Isn't that the reality, Ajay? So I think we are a deeply immoral society which is not able to even figure out differences between right and wrong. And we all at some stage becomes intermediaries or middlemen for something. There are days when I help people to get their passports quickly out. And there are other middlemen who will for a fee help you get things done. I think if you look at the larger mainstream political system itself, you'll realize that the entire Indian politics looks like some drug mafia. You know, they're the world's biggest black money operations. But how many of our politicians would accept that reality. And look at the very senior most, the Prime Minister of India, talking about black money, when he has come to power on huge deployment of black money in politics. So I think we are a deeply immoral society. We are unable to accept the fact that we have sunk so low in our moral values. So I think it's okay. I mean, I think we look with admiration at our neighbor or our own parents or siblings who make extra kickbacks out of deals. And we admire the people who build the biggest houses. We look at those who get caught and land up in jail with some amount of pity and saying that, look, you are not smart enough, right? So I think that's what I've been trying to argue.
You may have read in the newspapers that Josy has been slapped with a civil defamation suit of 1,000 crores by Jet Airways for an expose he wrote here about the Jet Airways deal. 1,000 crores is what, or were there two cases, if I'm not wrong?
There are two consecutive suits. They have said 1,000 crores. I don't know if it will add up to 2,000 or whether the amount will be 1,000.
You are a rich man, Josy.
Yeah, I didn't know I got such market value.
So, Josy has been sued for 1,000 crores or 2,000 crores by Jet Airways. We should hear from him what he wrote about Jet Airways in the book. I think you should know.
Yeah, but, you know, my book has three sections. First section is about the kind of middlemen who can get your work done at various levels in this country. And in the second segment of the book, I zero in on aviation to talk about how people without any known riches or great business background landed up in Mumbai or when economic liberalization happened, and they dramatically built up some of India's most famous companies. I narrate the entire story through two young men, one from Kerala and the other from Punjab, who lands up in Mumbai. And the one from Kerala built up India's, launched India's first private airline when liberalization happened. It's called, I don't know how many of you remember East West Airlines. Its promoter, Taqiyuddin Wahid, was killed in 1995 in Mumbai. And his business rival was a man called Naresh Goyal, who came from Punjab, and he used to be a ticketing assistant in some small time travel house in Delhi. He came to Mumbai and launched Jet Airways, and went on to be a flourishing business, and today Jet Airways is a large international airline. In the book, I talk about the fact that there were repeated evidences of Naresh Goyal's links with underworld, Dawood Ibrahim, India's most wanted man, and his gang. And there were questions about how he got funding to start his airline, and questions about the fact that he used hawala and other illegal means to route money, and etc. And these are all on official government files, and I have only quoted from the government files. But strange as it may be in modern India, the book came out in July, and I don't think anybody in the government even bothered to look at what I'm saying. But Naresh Goyal has had the audacity to go to Bombay High Court and accuse me of defaming him based on government documents. So I think it's a fight that I'm going to enjoy. I want to see how far, and I'm very confident that the judiciary is very independent in this country. But I want to see for me it's a great education to see whether truth in itself is defense in this country, or there is something more to it or not.
That was an interesting statement about your trust in the courts, and we'll come to that in a short while. But you said you are looking forward to that fight, is that right?
Of course. I think we should all enjoy all fights. I enjoy all fights. I get into, though it makes me tense or worried, I don't that usual human emotions. But I think unless you have the heart and mind to enjoy such a fight, you can't do investigative journalism, because you are going after somebody.
Okay. So what is the crux of your finding about Naresh Goyal?
The crux is that the fact that he became NRI one sudden day in 1991, and within months, hundreds of thousands of dollars came into a company called Tailwinds in the tax haven of Isle of Man. And from there, he transferred that money into India and started Jet Airways. And he used his status as NRI, which he got only a few weeks earlier, never to answer the question about where he got the money from. Till date, he has not answered the question. And I tell this entire story through the few days after 1999 hijack of Indian Airlines aircraft, which was taken to Kandahar. After the Kandahar hijack, the government said that they will be very tough on security clearance for airline companies given the in the background of Kandahar hijack. So, over the next several months, government kept refusing security clearance to directors and companies of major airlines, including MESCO, the Safdarjung Flying Club, etc. because they had cases of corruption against them or things like that. But in one case, just in one case of Jet Airways, there was a very dramatic play by the Home Ministry under L.K. Advani, the man who swore to all of us to fight underworld and black money and all that. And in about 2 years from that, Home Ministry passed on the responsibility of giving security clearance to Jet Airways to the Civil Aviation Ministry. That's the only company where they didn't take up the responsibility. And that is how the security clearance for Jet Airways happened. These are all captured in documents. So I've quoted from the documents. And that's the only company where there is letters written by Intelligence Bureau Chief and other senior officials where they say that he is known to be linked to Dawood Ibrahim and his gang. He is known to have received Hawala route.
Intelligence Bureau has written that, is it?
Yeah, there is one of the documents that I've got shown in the book is a letter signed by then Intelligence Bureau Chief K.P. Singh. And there are other letters of joint director.
K.P. Singh comes quite often in the whole episode, yes.
Yeah. So, Jet Airways got the clearance and ever since that it has been going on. Now, according to Jet Airways court filing, they say that in 2007 they got a clean sheet from a PAL that was filed in Bombay High Court. And what's a PAL? One journalist went to Bombay High Court accusing underworld links to Jet Airways and produced one letter among the many documents that are available. The court, in all its wisdom, asked the Bombay police to file an affidavit on the document. The Bombay police, the great investigators that they are, they call up the journalist saying that, can you get the original of this document? He says, I don't have the original. And based on that, the Bombay police has filed an affidavit in Bombay High Court saying that there is no evidence and nothing more to prove. And the great judges that were on the bench accepted that argument. And that's a ridiculous background to the entire case. That's what I'm saying. I'm just looking forward to this fight because I want to know. Anyway, I don't have the 1,000 crores to give. But there are other things that I could learn and understand.
Intelligence Bureau, when it writes, the government doesn't act on it. Is that what you find?
Yeah. So
is it brushed aside, put it under the files, or the documents destroyed?
Documents can't be easily destroyed. The only documents that are destroyed are those in the custody of intelligence agencies because they are not accountable to the parliament or courts or anybody. And that is something that we should be worried about because this is the only large democracy where intelligence agencies are not accountable to any of the external agencies. And that is why we have had the Mecca Masjid case where some innocent Muslim boys are picked up and put in jail because some idiotic intelligence bureau officer cooks up a story of bomb blast. So there is no accountability. But those papers that are on the files of the Home Ministry cannot be destroyed, right? Those are numbered letters. I mean, I hope so. I want to see what will happen in the High Court. I'm waiting to see. Because those documents that I'm presenting are all numbered and filed.
And you have copies of them?
Of course.
We were talking a little while back about the Rolls-Royce case. I think that is something that the audience should know about.
You know, my book, I cover four different kinds of middlemen who can get your job done in modern India, whether it's at the village level or at the highest level. So, there is one chapter where I'm talking about arms deals and arms dealers. And most of the chapter is centered around this one-eyed man who lives in London and who can probably swing a major defense deal anywhere in the world and who is believed to be on the speed dial of people like Vladimir Putin, who is officially the second largest donor to Liberal Democratic Party of UK. His name figures in the Italian politics often. He is protected by the Israeli government because of his strategic importance in the defense industry of Israel. He has been accused twice in FIRs by CBI of fixing defense deals, but has never been charged. He lives a lavish life in UK. So, I talk about how he and his cronies have been able to pay bribes to General S.F. Roderick's family. A former army chief's family. I entered a lot of those things in the book. Now, for months after my book came out, I worked with the BBC and Guardian and others, and we have been looking at Rolls-Royce, which engaged this man, Sudhir Chaudhary, to win defense contracts in countries like India, Malaysia, China, etc. So, BBC Panorama did a program, I reported it in the Hindu. 2 weeks ago, no, last week, Rolls-Royce admitted to the Serious Fraud Office of UK to corruption, to engaging middlemen, to bribing income tax officials in India to remove documents recovered from Rolls-Royce office in India, to have bribed money to middlemen to swing the deal for advanced jet trainer Hawk, which is used in the Air Force Academy not very far from here, and to have paid bribes for another engine deal for Navy. This is official court filings in UK. I reported it in Hindu about, I think, a week ago, and later some papers I've also reported. But the great government of India has not moved. Nobody is bothered. Rolls-Royce is paying 5,600 crore rupees fine in UK for bribery paid in India. But we are not bothered. That's the state of affairs.
That's unnerving.
Should be unnerving, and we should be worried about it.
That's unnerving. There is evidence, there is admission of guilt. That's admission of guilt of crime in India.
That's right, and there is a High Court judgment in London which is in public domain now. So, you know, we have built a deeply immoral political system, and it irritates, upsets one to know, and elections are fed by the kind of money that are paid by these kind of middlemen and corporates. Then they lecture us about morality, and then they declare demonetization and whatever rubbish that they do. Without that one honest admission that they are among the leading hoarders and spenders of black money in this country. And I think unless that fundamental change and challenge comes in, we will be keep talking like this year after year in festivals and other events. And one good thing is that I might end up writing some books and make some money, or maybe somebody will do a movie or something, you know, that's it. But otherwise nothing fundamental will change in this country.
In fact, in the book on middlemen, there's a very fine chapter on middlemen. And he writes about how middlemen are the fulcrum of this country. You can do what you want. There's a middleman available to make it happen. It says, if you fight persistently, you can get something you deserve with a lot of difficulty. If you have money, you can get it without a fight. The Indian democracy works only through middlemen who know how to get the moribund system moving. And the kind of examples that he narrates are amazing. You also talked of the Adani Group's excise evasion, customs evasion.
Yeah, when I wrote the book, there was only one where there was very clearly documented evidence in the Directorate of Revenue Intelligence of Adani Group taking out something like 5,800 crore rupees out of India to Mauritius in the name of purchase of power equipment. They bought power equipment from South Korea and China for about 3,000 some crore rupees. But they created a fake company in Dubai which issued vouchers for something like 9,000 crore rupees, which were produced in India and with bank loan as usual. Most of the money loaned by public sector banks where you and I are responsible shareholders or account holders. Money was moved to Dubai, and the 3,000 some crores to be paid to South Korea and China went into the legal route. Rest of the money moved to Mauritius. When this case was filed, and this case was put up before the first administrative decision of the Narendra Modi government was to set up an SIT on black money. So when this case came up before the SIT on black money, they sent the case to Enforcement Directorate to be probed under Prevention of Money Laundering Act. The file was sent to Ahmedabad. The young officer of Enforcement Directorate who was heading the Ahmedabad office of Enforcement Directorate was raided by CBI, has been shunted out. We haven't heard anything about what happened to the Adani case. Now it's almost 3 years. And in the meanwhile, there are more reports about other illegalities by groups like Adani, on whether it's calling boards or other things. So it is not just about Adani or Ambani or one particular group or the other. Most of these people are thriving on it, and they thrive on this because they know that the political system would not show the courage to put anyone of them in jail. Because ultimately those political parties and systems are run on the kind of kickbacks that these people pay to them.
Again, in the very interesting section on middlemen, he writes, in short, he must ensure that the government keeps running in the sinister and corrupt way that has become the norm. It would be no exaggeration to say that these powerful intermediaries play a critical role in ensuring that the Indian government does not grind to a halt. Its armed forces modernize regularly, that highways are constructed, and the economy keeps growing at a robust rate rather than stagnant.
You don't think so? I mean, you know, I was just talking about Sudhir Chaudhary and the advanced jet trainer. The
Sudhir Chaudhary seems to be a very critical name in this country.
But nobody knows him. Nobody knows him.
More than one Sudhir Chaudhary.
I was talking about the advanced jet trainer Hawk, which Air Force bought for training Air Force fighter pilots. Rolls-Royce has admitted to having paid bribes to Sudhir Chaudhary for ensuring the deal, for the deal. Now, the fact is that Hawk is an outstanding trainer aircraft. In a normal democracy, in a normal, efficiently running economy, it could have been bought without paying bribes to anybody because it has been selected by Air Force and its technically capable teams. But in India, to ensure that a good product, which is very much necessary for the Air Force and the country's armed forces, is bought in time and for whatever money, to ensure that you need a man like Sudhir Chaudhary and his cronies hanging around and paying bribes to various kinds of people. So in a very sinister way, it is middlemen like Chaudhary or others who ensure that the system is running. So at the lowest levels in our country, in village offices or others, when you go there to get a birth certificate or a death certificate or whatever, you need to pay some bribe to somebody. So if you don't pay bribe, and if that lubricant called bribe is not there, then these government machineries could actually come to a grinding halt. That's what my argument is. And I think that's a reality.
That's reality. No question about it.
Look at highway constructions. Look at our road contracts. I mean, look at the kind of money that's being paid.
In fact, in the introduction of your chapter on the very private sector, you say this. This is an instructive manual on how to do business and succeed in modern India. This is how he introduces that chapter. This is an instructive manual on how to do business and succeed in modern India. The three chapters here are merely illustrative of course. An enterprising soul could come up with an entirely fresh, uncharted trajectory. India is the land of endless opportunities to bribe and make money.
Yeah, this is the introduction to the section on aviation. I picked on aviation because that is where Naresh Goyal's case also has come up. I picked on aviation because, most of us know and many of us don't know the fact that aviation has had a very glorious history in this country. A man called J.R.B. Tata actually flew in the first civilian aircraft, and it's a rich man with the maverick vision who builds this entire industry. And while he would fly from Juhu, where there was a temporary runway, he would actually end up landing in some village and all that, because there was no runways, no airports and all that. And he went on to build Air India, which before it was nationalized, used to be one of the world's finest airlines. And look where it has reached now. And Air India has not reached this state of abysmal affairs, not just because of its lack of professionalism among its employees. It is because of a very sinister political plot to destroy one of our greatest institutions so that the private sector could benefit. And which is actually the story of a lot of the PSUs and others. In the world's one of the most booming telecom markets, government-controlled telecom companies are all in debt and in great losses. Nowhere else in the world it would happen. So look at any segment. You can see examples of people who just manipulate, bribe, and find their way up. And when they become rich enough, unless you are, a slightly country bumpkin like Subrata Roy, you don't even need to go to jail. Right? Agencies can file FIR against you, but it's okay. You just have to manage the system. And managing system, many of our famous people, in fact, the very famous faces that represent India in World Economic Forums or other global stages, are many of them marauders and criminals who have found their way up because they could manipulate the system.
I also had highlighted a very interesting paragraph in his book which says, India's socialist economy has not been replaced by laissez-faire in these decades. The government did not really withdraw from the marketplace or regulations. If anything, it found new ways to coerce and assist a new breed of business people as the scope widened dramatically. What is constant is the grip of the corrupt politician, businessmen, criminal syndicates on governance. It is even greater than anything that the average observer of Indian democracy can imagine, even in these days of exposes and hidden cameras. You could not have said better than that. Now, tell us about your experiences with courts and what gives you the confidence that you will be able to sail through by just showing the truth.
You have to have some naive confidence in, and optimism if you want to do investigative journalism and to keep pushing forward. So I can't sit back knowing well that there are huge drawbacks in our judicial system. And say that, oh my God, I'm going to lose a case. No, I don't. I have to be optimistic. So I would be optimistic till the last day. It's also very important not to take yourself very seriously. So if I don't take myself very seriously, then it's yet another case in a country where there are courts of cases pending. Let's see. I'll fight. There is no other way to deal with this issue.
But you also know how the courts work. The Supreme Court recently gave its order on the Sahara Birla Diaries, and that order is patently against law. Right? There is a written law which does not allow an order of that kind to be passed, and yet it was passed, and it helped people. It helped the powers that be. It helped the people who were involved in that. What makes you believe that you are more powerful than Naresh Goyal is? I hope you are, by the way.
on Birla Sahara Diary, I worked on it for 3 months. And when we published, there was at least, we published in a very soft way in Hindu, but at least we opened it up in public domain. The government was, there was deadly silence from the government side, but one person kept creating havoc in my life for an entire day, which was Jayanti Nagarajan, because there was remarks about Jayanti being bribed or something. Now, to me, these are telling signs of our times, that somebody who was forced out of the government for allegations of corruption, etc., and was finally left the party, or Congress party, took such high moral ground, saying that, look, why are you naming them, why are you pinpointing me? And I kept saying that, look, your name is now part of assembly proceedings in Delhi, now it's in the Supreme Court, Prashant Bhushan has taken the Supreme Court, but she wouldn't have it. So, I'm very used to dealing with situations where it's not black and white. I'm very used to dealing with people who can take any high moral ground or nothing. I'm very used to dealing with other issues of whatever you call it, intimidation or threat, which I don't like talk about. But what I'm not used to is to have a sense of self-importance. I don't have it. So I don't want to believe that I'm some big hero and I'm going to be smart here. No, I'm not. I'm going to fight like any other Indian citizen. And I'm going to spend as much money that I can afford to fight my case. But I want to see. For me, it's a great education. Maybe at the end of the day, I might come out with a new book about Indian courts, my own experience. But I'm going to fight. I'm reading up on a lot of on defamation these days. I was other day reading about Mahatma Gandhi very famously refused to apologize to court and all that. So I'm also reading up, I'm educating, let's see. But the fact is that Indian democracy, with all its ills and weaknesses, it's probably the world's greatest human experiment through the last 60,000 years of human history. And whenever we thought that darkness has descended on us, whether it's emergency period or whether it's after riots or whatever, I think there have been very powerful rays of hope and light that have come up from our own institutions. So I think we should wait for them and be optimistic about those powerful rays of hope and promise and optimism than be in despair about what is going wrong. Because if I even to despair, then I won't be able to do the next story. I want to do one, go on to the next story. I don't want to be losing my sleep about the airways. I would move on to the next story. That's what.
That's an amazing approach to have. That's an amazing approach to have. A Hyderabadi filmmaker is making a film on the basis of his book and him. And this is a recent development. Would you like to tell us about it? There's a filmmaker here.
He's there. Nobody else.
That's right.
Raj Madiraju, he is known to many of you because he's a state award winning filmmaker here. They're getting big time into Hindi production. So they've taken the rights to my life and they're hoping to do a biopic. I'm hoping to be famous. But I hope it won't make me so famous that I won't be able to do the next story, you know, because next story is more important than the movie. So, but
I hope you get enough money to take care of your case.
No. No, but I think I mean good luck to him. I'm so happy that but you know, there's one thing that I wanted to mention. I'm just talking about the optimism about India. Taken the option to my life. I've had at least 3-4 filmmakers approaching me to do movies based on various chapters in the book. There have been such good response. There's a generation of filmmakers like him who are very political, who are very out there wanting to tell the truth about India, wanting to stand up and contribute in their own way. So I'm saying that while overall it might look gloomy, there are very strong points of dissent that are out there. Whether it's in the film fraternity, you know, I was in Bombay I gave a TED talk in Bombay. I had some of the famous people in the audience standing up and applauding me, you know, when I said that you need to celebrate investigative journalism. Otherwise, you won't be able to come back here and sit like this again. So I think all kinds of shades exist in this country. So films definitely is one medium where you see a lot of political intervention by good filmmakers. Books, non-fiction books, we are seeing strong writing.
But now that black money has been eradicated, we should have an easier and better life.
I have to congratulate him. And we need more like you, Josy. So my question is, how do you follow up your investigation? How do you get access to papers and documents? Because it mustn't be easy. How do you go about your investigation?
There are a lot of good people out in the system. It's not that I'm the only one who is angry about injustice. There are a lot of civil servants, bureaucrats, police officers, intelligence officers. How would I get the entire file on the airway? Somebody gave it to me, right? So there are a lot of good people. That's number one. Number two is, I think I treat investigative journalism more like an academic work. So it's like doing an academic research. I can sit on a story for years to come, and until I get the documents, I won't publish. So the airways, I've been after that the airway story for almost a decade now. It's not dramatic because I don't do hidden cameras. I don't cheat on people. I tell people who I am. I never hide my identity. I don't like to do that. So it's more academic to me. But out there in the system, there are a lot of courageous men and women out there who will very quietly come and give you the document, give you a tip off. I just came in the last half an hour. We had a small session where somebody told us some very sensational stuff. So wherever we go, people come. Yesterday, somebody mailed me from Hyderabad, asking me how he could blow the whistle on his own organization. I think he's in the audience. I'm hoping to meet him. So, you know, there are a lot of people out there. So I think I am only an extension of the goodness in the system. I just happen to be the byline for it. I'm not the courageous. The courage is out there. Yeah.
You talked about the middlemen. Then you must be knowing D.P. Tripathi. Sharad Pawar, how does he get the, you know, the President Award and all those things? Yeah.
Padma Bhushan or Padma Vibhushan?
Padma Vibhushan.
Vibhushan, sir. I think it is very telling and symbolic of our times. I was not surprised, and I'm not surprised. Because you will be surprised by Sharad Pawar getting Padma Vibhushan, only if you are assured that there is a counter political narrative that is running the country. I'm saying that no, they are all the same narratives. Somebody keeps talking about black money demonetization and all sorts of things, but he's not different from Sarath Pawar today. In fact, what BJP has done, BJP is singular, the BJP under Modi, I think its biggest contribution to worsening the situation is to build up a political process that is several times more expensive. BJP has taken it to unbelievable heights. I was in Bihar before the last law, state assembly election. BJP was paying salary up to the block level, office bearers. So they are all the same. There is no counter political system that has emerged. Unless that emerges, they will keep giving each other Bharat Ratnas and Padma Vibhushans. They will praise each other, and before us they will put up show of dissent and disagreements and fight on black money. Those are all drama that to fool you and me. You know?
Hi Josy, nice to hear second time. First I heard you at Manthan, and now it is the second time. Like you said, Chatterway story is 10 years old. They put the case now. Why now?
No, that is because my book came out only in July.
But they obviously knew that you are behind them.
No. If the defamation happens, they won't
do it. Okay.
Then they would be publicizing it.
Second thing, it started from 1991 when so-called liberalization happened with Manmohan Singh and P. Narasimha Rao and all. And now it has come to stage where you yourself just now said it has come to unimaginable proportions. So where are we going now? Money is coming from London?
Money is coming from everywhere.
Okay.
Money is coming from us also. A part of the income tax that at least all of us pay is going into feeding all these things. We need to figure out what proportion of our income tax is being eaten up by the black money operations and political systems, and what percentage of it is being put to use. My vague assessment is that only a minority of the money that we contribute to the national exchequer is being used to anything productive, put to anything productive.
So where will we land in the next 10 years?
There is something that we do not talk about, which is that we are a very young country. The median age of India is only 27. We are talking about 60, 65 crore people who are less than 27 years old. The young are very impatient and angry. And I think they are the ones who are going to demand change, and they are going to bring about change. India Against Corruption was a very, very brief sneak preview of what India is going to witness. We have entered an era of serious large-scale civil protest. Whether we see among the Dalits or Muslims in Gujarat, or whether it's Jallikattu, or what is now being building up in Andhra, I suppose, it's all reflection of the larger unhappiness and among the, especially the youth. I hope leaders will emerge to channelize this disgruntlement to a very productive way, and democracy will move into a very more bold imagination. Until then, we are going to be like this.
Do you see that election, the need to get money to contest elections, is a major reason that people are going for this black money? And secondly, what do you see to be reforms that might happen that would reduce the role of black money in elections?
Yeah, so if you look at Indian political system, we are always in election mode. There is always an election happening, right? So politicians come to power, whether it's at state, especially at the central level, they come to power and then they are preparing for the next election, which may be 6 months down the line, 1 year down the line. And they are collecting money for that. If you look at segments like construction, when elections come closer, the consumption of cement goes down, the value of land drops, because the black money is diverted to elections. And then it comes back, then after elections it again picks up. You look at media balance sheets. Close to any election or around the period of the election, the media balance sheets look very good because we get a lot of advertisements and paid news or whatever we call it, you know, there are a lot of kinds of tamasha happens. State funding may be a solution, but I don't think that's the only solution, but this is we are in a very serious crisis. The crisis is much bigger than what we can understand, even I can understand or I can explain. In the run-up to 2014 Lok Sabha elections, one intelligence report was talking about 100 crore rupees every day on an average moving from Ahmedabad and Surat, the two cities of Gujarat, out to rest of India. 100 crore rupees a day. We are talking about $12-13 million a day moving through the Hawala routes. it's unbelievable skills. I know personally of politicians who have carried up to, you know, 5-6 crores, up to $1 million in cash in carry bags, using their immunity as ministers, and carried for election funding to various candidates. So it's unbelievable skill. So I don't know. I seriously don't know what the solution could be.
So your book is essentially a saga of institutional failure. So do you have any particular insights on what we can do to build accountable institutions?
I think accountability in public life, I have a theory. In public life, there is only one emotion, which is called fear. So I hope the youngsters like you create enough fear in the minds of the politicians to change. Otherwise, I don't think there is anything that, any solution, no solution is going to come easy. They have almost perfected a system where they get black money, they fight elections, all that. You have to stand up, and we have to stand up and create fear in their minds to change. That's the only solution.
Mr. Josy Joseph, congratulations for a lovely talk, especially about your optimism. My question to you is, in your investigation, have you been able to figure out why or how Vijay Mallya was not able to work the system, unlike Jet Airways?
He worked the system.
And then how did he, was he framed?
Yeah, so the fact is that he worked the system, he got all the money out, and he took some money out for himself. And he was able to escape India just as the banks were going into Supreme Court. Mind you, the bank's loan default is under the purview of 2-3 agencies. Central Vigilance Commission, Reserve Bank of India and Parliament, right? So he couldn't manage everything at one go, and that's not easy. So if you look at other big corporates who have taken loans, for example, Anil Ambani has taken something like 1,25,000 crore rupees loan from the bank. They are not default. Adani has something like 67,000 crore rupees loan. So Vijay Mallya just couldn't manage by, he could have easily rolled on by paying the basic necessary interest, etc. He failed because he is such a failure as a businessman in that sense. Because he didn't know how to manage system. He thought that he's flamboyant, chartered aircraft enough, and some liquor sent to the politician's house enough. That did not work. So he or Subrata Roy have not really fully figured out the system. That's why Subrata Roy had to spend time in jail, or Vijay Mallya had to flee in jail.
In the many, many cases you have investigated, has there been a case where you have been disappointed that actually you are chasing something for months or year together and then found that there was nothing? Can you tell something about that?
No, you know, what happens mostly is that one keeps looking at 2-3 different stories at any point of time. And majority of the stories never reach fructification because ultimately you need to have documents. I'm not a Hindi news channel chap standing out there at 9:30 and talking rubbish. I have to write based on documents. So often it is very difficult to get documents to back up your claim. You know the fact. I know the fact. But unless I have the document, I can't talk about it. Sahara Birla papers, I went after it for 3 months. But I couldn't still write it as an independent story. I wrote it as a complaint filed by Prasanth Bhushan. Because how do I substantiate? Look at Meera Radia tapes. Who substantiated it? How did he cross-verify? Did a secondary source verify that these are not some mimicry artists and it is real voices of Ratan Tata and Meera Radia? So there are a lot of ethical issues involved in investigation. So that is a regular part of the game. I won't call it disappointment. That's part of the exercise. Right? But now what's happening is very interesting. Digitization is sweeping through the world in a big way, even in India. So MCA 21 today, for 100 rupees, I can take out the balance sheet and annual return of any company. And it tells me a lot of stories, right? So I think we have entered an era of great, exciting journalism. A significantly large number of it is going to be based on digital documents. And the misdeeds and criminality of a lot of our famous people are now getting digitized. They never thought that there is something called internet coming up, there is something called PDF that will come up, there is something called MCA 21. So it's exciting time. I wish I have more people with me to look at a lot of companies and a lot of people.
Good afternoon. Mr. Joseph, you made some comments about the Indian judiciary. So do you honestly feel that it is as independent and as uninfluenced as it has to be? As a law student, I must have asked a very sacrilegious question, but I really want to know. And do you intend to do some kind of investigation in this matter?
Of course. Yeah, I mean, investigation, of course. But I hope, and that's my belief, and I have to believe in the fact that Indian judiciary is independent. there are enough stories and rumors that we hear, and I hope all of them are wrong. Because I can't give in to pessimism in a wholesale manner, you know. I have to have optimism in something. But there are serious flaws in our judiciary, in the way judicial appointments happen, in the way government tries to get into judicial appointments. There are a lot of improvements required, and I'm only a byline among the few bylines which keep reflecting the larger concern. There are people out there like Prasanth Bhushans or others who are, for decades have been consistently fighting judicial accountability, for judicial accountability. Improvements happen, sometimes we go back, we come ahead. But I think in courts, there definitely is far more democratic discussion happening around law than in parliament or anywhere else. So to that extent, Indian judiciary is far better than, let's say, parliament or the civil bureaucracy.